So if you want to hop in, feet on the parachute. The yep, straight on. And sit down. Feet on the rudder bars.
It's actually pretty roomy.
Yeah, you wait.
This is the legendary Supermarine Spitfire, an airplane so crucial to the Battle of Britain during World War II that at its peak, each Spitfire and its pilot had a life expectancy of just 6 weeks. It had almost no electronics on board, carried only 15 seconds worth of ammunition, and had no ejection seat. And yet, this aircraft was state of the art in the 1940s. Surprisingly, almost a century later, you can just feel how well this aircraft was built, if you're lucky enough to get a chance to sit in its cockpit.
Doesn't that feel great?
It does. It makes me want to go learn how to fly.
But why the Spitfire should never actually spit fire during engine start. How this little red button was crucial to the pilot's survival in flight. And why the Spitfire's rudder has an unusual Z shape instead of being flat like most other aircraft. It's not what you think. The Spitfires were fighter reconnaissance platforms, hence the designation FR. The original Spitfire Mark I carried 4 guns under each wing and shot 303 caliber bullets, which looked like this. Now compare that to this Spitfire Mark XIV, which was one of the last models to fight in the Second World War. As an interceptor, this aircraft had 2 50 cal machine guns, one on each wing. Here's what that projectile looked like. And for some extra punch, the aircraft was also equipped with 2 20 millimeter cannons, which fired this monster. What's interesting is that each mission was typically no longer than an hour, because the pilot had only about 4 or 5 trigger squeezes, each 2 to 3 seconds long, to target German bombers. The aircraft was then completely out of ammo and had to come back down, refuel, rearm, and go back out. That's because each 20mm cannon only had 125 rounds, and each 50 cal machine gun was loaded with 250 bullets. The Mark 14 Spitfire simply could not carry much more ammunition due to weight restrictions. Spitfires had angled guns, so the bullets fired would eventually converge. Even though the aircraft's gunshots were most commonly set to meet at about 750 feet, the convergence could be adjusted to anywhere from 300 to 1400 feet in front of the aircraft, tightening the stream of fire into a circle roughly 4 feet wide. By the way, this is Robert Moverley. Not only did his father serve in the Royal Air Force and work on Spitfires during World War II, but Rob himself now carries that heritage forward as the crew chief of this Mark 14 Spitfire here at the Commemorative Air Force Museum in Camarillo, California. As you'll see, Rob is extremely knowledgeable and extremely British.
By a company, you mean aluminum? I mean aluminium.
As for the reconnaissance role, Spitfires could be equipped with up to 3 cameras.
One camera could point out that side, one camera could point out this side, and another one could point straight down.
So it would have looked something like this. Now you might be wondering, what could the pilot possibly capture with the side cameras? During a low-level pass, Spitfires were able to capture detailed photos of the German Würzburg Rise radar under sight cameras. These images were used as the basis for Operation Biting, during which radar components and a human operator were seized for further analysis. With about 2,000 horsepower, the Spitfire was one of the few World War II propeller-driven aircraft that could fly straight up, vertically. But to accomplish that, as the British kept putting more powerful engines on this airframe, they needed bigger props and more blades, so the aircraft could pull better through the air. That's how, throughout the years, Spitfires went from 2-bladed props on Mark I all the way to 5-bladed props on the Mark 14, and then turned into this watch, which contains aluminum from a Mark I Spitfire piloted by Australia's highest scoring ace in the Battle of Britain, Patterson Clarence Hugh. The beautiful watch case resembles the nose and wing profile of the Spitfire with that unmistakable elliptical sweep, and the rotor is engraved with the silhouette of the aircraft. The bold yellow arms and Arabic numerals echo the yellow tips of the Spitfire's propeller blades, making the time stand out the exact same way the blades did while spinning. But the Spitfire's DNA is at 6 o'clock. That subdial is real aluminum, also known as aluminium, that's been reforged from the skin of Patterson's Spitfire. The authentic patina gives every watch a unique appearance. So if you want to proudly wear a piece of history on your wrist, check out our sponsor RecWatch using the link in the description and get 10% off when you use the code NWIT at checkout. Let history inspire your every moment forward. In case like me, you don't know much about flying airplanes either, here are the basics. This is called the stick. Moving it forward and backward controls the elevators in the tail of the aircraft. Pulling it toward you moves the elevators down, which in turn pitches the nose up. Or as Rob would say,
houses get smaller, houses get bigger.
Moving the stick left and right controls the ailerons on the wings, causing the aircraft to roll in that direction. The pedals move the rudder, which changes the yaw. Press the left pedal and the nose yaws to the left, and vice versa. Finally, there is the throttle. Pushing it forward gives you more power, which generally means you go faster. That's it, let's jump into the really cool details.
The Spitfire's got a very unusual control column. Normally, in an aircraft, the whole column moves across.
But in the Spitfire, only the top part of the stick moves, which is very convenient for the pilot, since the lower part of the column won't be hitting their legs.
You see, you're not having to move your legs at all.
Yeah, yeah.
Great system. The pilots absolutely love it. Find it very, very easy to fly.
And with regards to the elevators, what's that piece for?
You could have the elevator just straight across like that, but then your control pressures would be much higher.
That part is called the elevator horn balance. Think of it as a counterweight, so the pilot can move the elevator with less force.
Yeah.
It's an incredibly light movement.
Oh, yeah.
And you can feel how smooth it is.
Yeah, very smooth.
We work very hard to get that really smooth because it makes such a difference to the pilot when they fly.
The rudder also has a horn balance for the same reason. Another unique feature of the Spitfire has to do with the trim flaps. Now, almost any aircraft has trims on their elevators, which help the pilot keep the nose of the aircraft pointed in a certain direction without having to keep pulling or pushing the stick the whole time. The rudder too had a trim, but with quite an unusual shape.
Now this is not flat, no. This part.
On almost every other aircraft, the trim is just like it is on the elevators. It's a straight one like that. This had to have this trim with a Z, we say Z, shape in it.
Yeah.
And that prevents what's called a flat spot. There is a flat spot just about there because of the design of this aircraft, where if it was flat, you wouldn't get any trim effect at all. And then you move it a little bit and suddenly you get a lot of trim effect. This enables you to have, even when it's neutral, you've got some trim effect.
I see.
Yeah? So yeah. It just prevents
keeps it engaged.
You having this. Yes, that's the best way to look at it.
The movement of all the flight surfaces are controlled simply by cables and pulleys that run from the cockpit through the fuselage. And yet, it's hard to describe how natural it felt when you move the stick and pedals.
It's amazing how smooth it is.
In the heart of the fuselage, there's a little compartment where Rob keeps all the unusual tools that are required to keep this old lady happy.
That's the oil dipstick.
Oh, yeah.
See, it's graduated all the way up. It gives you an idea of how much oil you've got in there. It has to be put in exactly the right way to get exactly the right measure off it. To open the fuel cap, you have to have that.
I've never seen tools like this.
You want to see this?
That tool is used to open the cowlings, which are the panels on the front that cover the engine.
I mean, this would take you, what, like 5 minutes to open up?
It takes me half a day to take the panels off.
No.
Half a day.
Just this one?
Literally. No. That, this and the top. Half a day off, half a day back on. It's an absolute labor of love. It really is. they're the worst type of fasteners ever.
Once you're in the cockpit, the canopy can be closed by cranking this handle. With the canopy and the side door closed, it does start to feel a little tighter inside the cockpit. There are six primary flight instruments, all of which are analog. The reason the artificial horizon is all crooked is because the engine is off, and so is the vacuum system. Yes, there is a vacuum that runs in order to create suction and blow out air from here. This is what gets the gyroscope going. Without the vacuum and gyro, these flight instruments couldn't function properly. During flight, the pilot can't physically see what's happening immediately below the fuselage, and therefore relies on indicators. To know whether or not the undercarriage is up or down, the pilot relies on these indicator lights. There are also test switches to make sure that the up and down indicator lights actually work.
Now, if you're flying at night, that's a really bright light.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, because you're in absolute darkness. So, again, what would the English do?
There's a little piece of fabric that can be pulled out to cover the lights and make them less bright at night. And it retracts during daylight. Simple, yet effective. This is also an indicator, but for the split flaps that are under the wings. The only way the pilot would know for sure if the flaps had actually come down is when this indicator has moved up. And if you're wondering what these bulges are, they're called blisters. Most blisters were added to create space under the aircraft skin for the moving parts. The biggest blister, of course, was there to make room for the breech of the 20mm cannon. There are some exceptions, however, since this blister was simply added to reinforce a particular segment of the wing. And then there is this.
What is this thing?
That's the pilot's air conditioning system.
Really?
Yep, a little flap that opens and closes.
Now, there was a way to get some more air. That's because these aircraft had no ejection seats.
And remove it from the Velcro, is that okay?
Yeah, just be careful.
But I won't pull it, yeah.
Yeah, just definitely don't pull it.
To bail out, the pilot would jettison the canopy, roll the aircraft upside down, and simply drop out, hoping his parachute would open. Before Rob started up the engine on the Spitfire, we had to use a tug to push the aircraft out and away from the hangar. But before we could bring the tug into the hangar and hook it up behind the wheel, we had to first move the aircraft forward to make some room. Let me tell you, pushing 8,000 pounds on wheels is easier said than done.
Okay, a bit more forward.
A bit more?
Yep. Okay, now let's put the chocks in it.
You would think starting the engine would be as easy as removing the covers from the six engine exhausts on each side, then getting into the cockpit and flipping a switch. But there are multiple pages of checklists that even someone as experienced as Rob had to go through, which took a little less than 10 minutes.
Undercarriage indicator switch on, pre-oiled, air is on, brake pressure's good, no parking brake, radio transponder.
Compared to the fiery engine start that we saw earlier, this engine start was flawless. But not following the starting procedure could overflow the engine with fuel, and that's when you get the flame. That said, I was on standby with a fire extinguisher, just in case something went sideways. Remember, this aircraft was built 81 years ago, then shipped to India to serve with the RAF's Southeast Asia Command. Then, in 1978, its deteriorated body was rediscovered, transported to England, and restored. Today, only three of this particular model exist in flying condition in the world. So we want to make sure she's protected in case of any mishaps. But we can't talk about the Spitfire without talking about her sister, the Hurricane. The Hurricane accounted for over half of the total enemy aircraft shot down during the Battle of Britain, which was 3 months and 3 weeks long. But still, the Spitfire was, and still is, regarded as a far better fighter aircraft because of her superior speed, maneuverability, and high-altitude performance. And let's be real, she was the hotter of the two sisters. Hurricane is the one you marry. Spitfire is the one you fly. She's the one you fly.